My name is Menno de Jonge. I work for Royal BAM Group in the Netherlands as Director of Digital Construction. And I will talk today about the digital transformation in the construction industry. And I will use a lot of examples of the digital transformation in our company. So please enjoy.
Always great to listen to Norbert. I know Norbert for a long time. He has these amazing stories. He is able to present to us the whole formation of our universe from, what was it, 8 billion years ago to now. And what I really like in his presentation is that only the last 30 years, this digitalization is really coming up. And I think we are all happy to be in the midst of that, in the middle of that, because I think that's very special. I really made a decision for myself in university during the last couple of years of university to really focus on this area, IT in construction. And well, here I am talking about the digital transformation in the industry to you. So I would really like to talk about digital construction in our company. And I think I will stand here. Maybe people in the end will not see me, but at least the slides are visible in this way. My name is Menno de Jonge, Director of Digital Construction in Royal BAM Group. And I will go through this story with you. I will first start a short introduction to the company I'm working for, Royal BAM Group, show you what we're doing in that company. And then I will touch three main topics. I will start with the why, then I will start with the how, and finally finish with the what. So in my story, I will talk to you why we are really embracing this digital transformation in our company. I will then show you how my company is really engaging on that, what we are doing there. And finally, in the last part, I will show you a lot of examples of what we are actually doing. So what we are doing in this area. And Norbert already touched on that a couple of times and mentioned my name. And that will be mainly in the last part of my my presentation. So let's start with an introduction to BAM Group. The company is a company that is active in two business lines, construction and property and civil engineering. So those are the two main business lines. And we have operations in the Netherlands, in Belgium, Germany, UK and Ireland. Those are our main markets, our home countries. And we have a business in a BAM International organization that is active across the whole globe. So we are doing work across the whole globe. We have a small company called BAM PPP, and that's the company that's taking care of the financial and the legal structures for our PPP projects that are executed by these companies. We have, and I'm looking to this side because I have an additional screen here to look on. We have a revenue of about 6.6 billion euros last year. And the astonishing thing is that we only have a 1% profit. So if you look at the profit number, 63 million, it's only 1%. So that's way, way, way too low. So we really need to do something about that. And we really need to adopt new technologies, new ways of working. Because otherwise, Google, Katerra, Amazon, these kind of companies, and maybe also IBM, will start going into our industry and take over our industry and use these technologies in a better way and make profits which are much higher. So we really need to act. We really need to do something. And that's also one of the reasons what I'm doing in my company. We have an order book of almost 12 billion. We are a little bit smaller than Strabag, but still 20,000 employees. So there's a lot of people with a lot of knowledge, a lot of technical resources, and enough projects, enough work to practice on, to really improve ourselves. Looking at the mission and the vision of the company, and I won't go through all of it, but I really want to focus on this part. We are really trying to enable the right people in our company to capitalize on state-of-the-art knowledge, resources, and digital technologies. That's a very important part of our mission of our company. So really taking up these topics. And for this year, the board of the company has set four main important priorities. all around these technologies that were shown in the mission. So it's really about pre-construction management, really taking care of the design and work preparation, and focusing really on that part of the whole life cycle. So really focusing on this, that we can prepare our projects in a better way, and after that do it one time right, not making any more mistakes during the construction phase. Digitalization is a very important topic for the company this year and the coming years. IT standardization is a very important topic. We are using different IT tools which are not harmonized with each other. So here we need to do a lot of work, and getting our business in control is also a very important topic. And here we are talking about the last priority that Norbert was also talking about, talking about data, getting all the data that we are generating in our process, and really put dashboards on that, really get control over all that data in our projects. Get away from paper and digitalize all these topics. Some examples of some projects that we are doing. This is a project that we finished and will be opened in June of this year. It's in Scotland, in the city of Dundee. It's the Victoria and Albert Museum of Design. A very complex building, which was not able to build without digital technologies. So we really needed topics like BIM, building information management, and those kind of tools to build this this project. Another example, this one is in Amsterdam. It's a redevelopment of a former prison area in the city of Amsterdam. The old buildings will be demolished and new apartment buildings will be built in this area. And the special thing about this project, that the circularity will be a very important topic in this project. So all the concrete that is coming out of the old prison buildings will be reused in the new apartment buildings that will be built here. But also, for example, the prison bars in the prison cells will be reused in the balconies of these apartment buildings. The cell doors of the old prisons will be reused as small bridges in this area. So a lot of circular aspects in this project. And for the Netherlands, and I don't know how it's here for the Baltics, but in the Netherlands, circularity is a very important topic, and the Dutch government wants to be fully circular by 2050. So that's a big ambition, and I'm not sure if we are going to make that, but we are trying to do our best in these kind of projects on the area of circularity. This is also what we call a circular building. It's a smaller pavilion for ABN AMRO, the bank, and it was fully developed, designed in a modular way. So all the elements that are used in this building can be reused in other buildings. Of course, sustainability is very important. In this building, a lot of the old jeans from bank employees have been used for insulation in this building. So they collected old jeans of employees of the bank, and these are used in this building, in the ceilings, as insulation. So really looking into reuse of materials, very important. An example of some civil infra projects. Norbert already talked about their tunnel boring machine projects. We are also doing these kind of projects with our German company, Weiss & Freitag. They're also very big in these kind of projects. And this one is in the Netherlands, where we are boring one of these tunnels inside the city of The Hague. Another very impressive project, I think, myself, it's an art collection building in the city of Rotterdam. Also a very complex shaped building. Also here, digital technologies are used to a very high extent to really design and also build this project. Another civil project, the Fehmarnbelt Tunnel. It will be a new tunnel that's being built between Denmark and Germany, 15 kilometers of length, and we will produce all the elements for this tunnel in a production environment. So it's some sort of a modular factory close to the project location. These elements are built there and then towed to sea, sank to the bottom and covered with sand. So that way this tunnel is being fabricated. And the travel time between Denmark and Germany will be reduced to about 7 minutes with this tunnel. One of our examples of our projects in the BAM International, our international company, and this is a very special project. It's not a very complex project, but the complexity here is that this project is built on the Antarctic, so on the South Pole. And the complexity here is that we need to bring all these materials to this location. We need to bring employees to this location. And it's a very remote location, so we need to do that first time right. There's boats going to this location, but not every day or not twice a day, but only once per 3 months. So we really need to do the logistics very right in this project. We talked about 3D printing already, and I'm very proud that Royal BAM Group, my company, has built the world's first 3D concrete structural bridge in the world. And this is a picture of it. It's not very big. It's 9 meters long and 3 meters wide, so it's not the biggest bridge, but it's the first 3D printed concrete bridge. So we are very proud of that. You see here the same structure as Norbert showed in his 3D printed wall projects, but this is a bridge, and I will talk about that later in the presentation. And the last example I would like to show you is this one. It's the Museum of the Future in Dubai, in the Middle East. And it's known as the world's most complex building that is being built at this moment. And so this donut-shaped building being a very complex building, and I will also talk about that later in the presentation. So a quick overview, or maybe a long overview, of the company of BAM, giving you an impression of what we are doing. And I would like now to go into the why. And I think there's one slide that is the same as the one in Norbert's presentation, but you will recognize that slide later on. The industry, the construction industry, where you're all part of, is a very important industry. Our industry represents about 6% of the global GDP in the world, so very important. Much even more important, every euro that's invested in our industry generates about 3 times as much economic activity. So every euro invested generates 3 times as much economic activity, and because buildings have to be maintained, the facades have to be cleaned, etc., etc. So it's very important for generating economic activity in the world. The output of our industry is projected to be somewhere around $17.5 trillion in the coming years by 2030. So there's enormous growth in our industry, and we employ a lot of people. So these are very positive, good numbers. But there's also a downside, and Norbert already talked about that a little bit in his presentation. He used these kind of numbers, and these might be a little bit different, but I'm talking here about the industry or the built environment is responsible for about 40% of the use of energy. And we are responsible for about 40% of the emissions of CO2. And we are using up about 50% of the natural resources. I think about the sand Norbert was talking about. So not very good numbers. Yeah, these numbers are very high. There's a skills shortage in our industry. The industry is not very sexy for people to work in. People rather want to work in an IT company or in a bank or in a consultancy firm instead of the construction industry. So we have difficulties getting the right people into our industry. So we need to do something about that. Our margins are going down every year, looking into global studies. This was a study done by Turner and Townsend International Construction, and they had a market survey in 2016 showing even lower profit margins. And this 6% is a very high number compared to the 1% I talked about for BAM. But this is also engineering firms. This is entrepreneur. This is architectural firms, property development firms. So that number is a little bit higher than a company that's only doing construction. And the one on the bottom right is probably the most astonishing part of this slide, because only a quarter of our projects, 25% of our projects, are delivered within 10% of their original deadlines. So in time or in money. So only a quarter of the projects are delivered in time or within budget. So that's not very good. So that's why we have been looking into the productivity of our sector. And this is a famous study done by Stanford University in the US, looking into productivity in all the industries. And again, Norbert talked about this number, 150%. If you look at all the industries, excluding non-farm industries, excluding the farm industry, so all other industries excluding the farm industry, the productivity has grown by about 150%. But if you look at our industry, the construction industry, that has actually dropped by about 20% over the last 35 years. So that's a bad number. And this is the digitalization index of our industry. Also there you see that our industry is always somewhere at the bottom of these kind of lists. I have been doing a presentation at Shell, the oil company in the UK, Netherlands, recently. And that was the first time I could talk to an audience that was even below our industry. So normally that's not the case. This is the slide that Norbert also showed. So if you combine these two numbers, the digitalization index and the productivity growth, you see that we are in the far bottom left corner of this graph, even below agriculture, forestry, fishing, and hunting. Unbelievable, but true. So something needs to change. One of the reasons why our industry is not productive and why we have these issues in our industry is that we have a very siloed organization in our business. We have a lot of stakeholders, a lot of companies that are doing small things in our industry. And they're all siloed, organized in siloed, in silos. And we are doing our work in a life cycle, and different companies are responsible for smaller parts of that life cycle. So they try to add value to the project in the planning phase, in the design phase, in the construction phase. They all try to add value, but at the end of the phase, the value drops because we hand over information on paper, for example, or on a A0 sheet drawing that is handed over from the end of the design to the construction phase. And then the work preparation people start measuring with measuring tapes and those kind of things. So they start to do a lot of work again. So there's a lot of rework in these processes. Often when I'm showing this picture, people tell me it's wrong, because especially at the handover from the construction phase to the operation and maintenance phase, that dot should be somewhere here, because we are almost never handing over any information from end of construction to the operation and maintenance phase. What we want to do is we want to apply this digital approach, really using digital systems to really store this information in central databases and really keep track of that information during the whole life cycle. We really want to reuse the information in all these steps. And the green dotted line is showing that we currently act as every project is unique. So we always start here at the bottom, always start at zero. But of course, we can reuse a lot of information in our projects. We can reuse information and start at a much higher value level than we are doing now. And reuse data, reuse information, and make use of that. So this is one of the reasons why the industry is not productive enough. There's a lot of consultancy firms that have done a lot of studies, and I won't go into the details, but this is one done by McKinsey, showing you a lot of enablers to improve the low productivity in our sector. And on the right hand, you see the estimated cost savings that McKinsey has studied on. And in total, that adds up to about 27 to 38% of potential cost savings in our industry. So these are huge numbers. These are enormous numbers. And here, the 50 that is shown at the bottom of this graph is the actual productivity gap between our industry and other industries. So according to McKinsey, using these kind of enablers, we can really raise the maturity or the productivity in our sector. And of course, there's a lot of these consultancy firms that are doing these kind of studies. This one is from the Boston Consulting Group, showing similar kind of numbers, 13 to 21% of cost savings in design, engineering and construction by applying full full-scale digitalization. So all these consultancy firms come up with these kind of numbers. And if we could even get a percentage of these cost savings in our industry, if we can only create maybe 3 or 4% of cost savings in our industry, our profits will go up enormously. And there's a lot of technologies out there that can really help us raising this productivity. And I like this graph very much. This is from a study from the World Economic Forum of May 2016. And it's really showing the likelihood on the vertical axis that new technologies will be implemented. And on the horizontal axis, it's showing the impact that these new technologies will have. And of course, integrated BIM is at the top right corner. We are all talking about BIM in our industry. And this study is really showing that that has a very high impact and also a very high likelihood to be implemented. But other technologies like prefabricated building components that Uponor is also heavily investing in, prefabrication done in factories, using iPads on a construction site, for example, really mobile collaboration, things like Internet of Things, 3D printing, 3D laser scanning, 3D printing of components, all these technologies can have a large contribution to raising our productivity in our sector. We really need to work on these topics, and we are doing that in our company. There's a lot of governments, national governments in Europe that have big programs in their countries to convince the construction industry to really apply these new technologies. In the UK, for example, they have the Digital Built Britain program that's running for a couple of years already. And they set, when they started, these targets for that that program. So they want 33% lower costs in the industry, 50% lower emissions, 50% faster delivery, and all the knowledge that they're going to build up, they also want to export that to the Netherlands and to the Baltics and to Germany, and also make money out of that. So that's one of the things that the UK is doing. And in 2013, 2014, they measured that they already saw an improvement of about 1,800 million British pounds as savings in the construction industry costs alone. So they are telling that they are successful there. One of the things they are doing in the UK is they built this levels of maturity diagram where they showed a number of levels of maturity in the industry. And it's really about making steps to a higher maturity level. So level zero is really about what Norbert was showing with the trucks. Everything is exchanged on paper. All the data is gathered on paper, and paper is sent around in the companies. Level one is the first level of really applying digital technology. So it's working with 2D computer-aided designs, 2D CAD systems, 3D models, but still data can be exchanged on paper. Sometimes it will be sent through email, or it will be used, stored on servers and using FTP protocols, these kind of things. And level two is the level that the UK is aiming for, and there digital information is really stored in central databases. 4D and 5D technologies are applied. All these kind of things are being done. And finally, level three is seen as the best way of working, where all companies, all stakeholders in the whole life cycle are working together on the digital information. So information is stored and taken out of this central environment. The UK has set mandates for companies in the UK to apply to BIM level two. So if you want to work for the government in the UK, you must be accredited towards BIM level two. And companies like Lloyds and BSI are setting schemes in place to really have companies certified towards this level of maturity. So our company is really focusing on that. UK and Ireland is certified already. In the Netherlands, our companies are certified to this standard, and also in Germany and Belgium, we are now heavily working on certifying towards this standard because we think it's very important. And the good thing there is that also internally, all the processes in our companies are really being redeveloped, rethought about, and it really has a very positive impact on the processes in our companies. I won't bore you with this slide too much, but there's a lot of standards out there. These are all the British standards that have been developed the past 1192. That's really explaining and showing how to work in your company. And this is also the basis for an international standard, an ISO standard, the ISO 19650, which is really showing how to work with data, how to work with information in your processes, in your companies. The European Union also has developed this a handbook for using or for the introduction of building information modeling by the public, European public sector. So there's a big document available from the European Union really talking to the European governments to really apply similar techniques as also have been applied in the UK. And more countries in Europe are using these kind of mandates. So that was the why we really need to go into this this digital transformation. Next part is the how. How are we doing that in BAM? Because we see enormous potential for improvement. And we really see that using these digital technologies, we can really improve the insight in our projects. Things get much more clearer during the whole life cycle of a project. We see that we can do an integrated design of our projects and our projects. We see a raise in efficiency, failure costs are being reduced. All these kind of things we see as important potential for improvement. Also things like safety, which is very important. And by applying these technologies, we can make our work sites much more safer. And finally, we can increase the value for all our stakeholders. We use internally a wise thought by Abraham Lincoln. He says the best way to predict the future is to create it. And that also reflects to the title of my presentation. We create the future using digital technologies. And our CEO always says we make it before we make it. So we are doing the work in a digital way first. We prepare it digitally first. And after that, we are physically preparing it, physically creating it. And I have now a short video showing you the vision of BAM in this digital transformation.
This is B, the B of BAM. The B of building houses, roads and infrastructures, and the B of the bricks to be building with. Today, people, companies and ideas all move from A to B. But in the future of building, new technologies create new opportunities, making B merely a starting point. The future of building and the journey of BAM exists beyond B, in a world that's vastly different, yet right around the corner. See? This is our vision, the direction we're heading in. Our journey is from B to C, to a future where builders become creators, where we make it before we make it, where all the bricks follow the clicks. Where we don't start a project at the beginning, but continuously learn from past projects and experiences. Where business planning becomes co-creation with our colleagues, customers, and all our stakeholders. Where we are no longer building in isolation, but where all our structures are connected through a continuous stream of data. The more we collaborate, the quicker we unlock potential. Today we are building the present, but have already started creating the future. We are moving to see. For ourselves. For our customers. And for the world. Join us today, and together we will move to see. BAM moves from B to C. Let's move together.
So let's move together linking back to the introduction again. We see two sides of digital construction in our company. On the left side of this slide, you see really the addition of digital techniques to our processes. So we're using building information management, we're using augmented and virtual reality, we're using 3D printing, robotics, all these kind of technologies that improve or digitalize our processes. And on the right side, you see the use of digital in our built environment. So that's more in our operation and maintenance phases of our project. There we use smart devices or robots, for example, robot cleaners in our schools and hospitals that we are maintaining. We are using a lot of sensors in our buildings to really predict maintenance and predict towards the future. Also about smart communities and really digital exploitation, using this data in these buildings. So these are the two most important sides of digital construction in our company. And this picture is really showing the ambition that we have as a company to really work towards. So we want to be here, want to move to a situation where we are applying this life cycle in our projects. So there we see two main parts of this life cycle. We see a digital part of the life cycle, digital first, and we see a physical part of our life cycle, physical next. So in the digital phase, we really start scanning a current situation. So we start creating 3D point cloud scans, those kind of things, using drones and all these technologies. But it can also be a manual scan of what we need to do in a project. So we create a lot of data here, and that data is being used to start creating a new design for a building or a road or a tunnel. So here we use a lot of BIM technologies to design the new environment. And then we start simulating, and that's maybe the most important part of the whole process, because we are using AR and VR technologies to really simulate our design. We are looking into sustainability, we're looking into logistics, we're looking into all different aspects to really simulate the digital version of a project. So we create a digital twin, as we call it, a digital copy of what we're going to create later in a physical way. Once this digital twin is fully realized, fully finished, we can start going into the physical phase and most ideally do that first time right. And we would like to go more and more into factories, so start producing the largest possible elements in factories. So there, we want to move our production from construction sites more to factories. Then we start moving these to the construction site. There we are going to assemble our buildings like an IKEA or Lego puzzle. And finally, we start living or using these the buildings or the roads or the tunnels. So that's the process. And during these steps, we generate a lot of data, a lot of information, which is stored in a platform, a Connect platform, and that's used to learn and make our processes more and more efficient. And we have two approaches to getting towards this fully new situation. My focus is really on the left side of this slide. I am trying to add digital technologies to current existing traditional processes. So it's more the Volvo or BMW way of working, adding digital technologies to existing processes. We have a startup in our organization called BeHome, and BeHome is really starting with a completely blank sheet of paper, and they are developing a platform for a completely digital way of working in our industry, the BeHome organization. So they're more using the Tesla way of working. If you look at a Tesla car, that's all full, the dashboard is, there's probably only two or three buttons and the rest is all digital. So they really start in a digital way. I am working on the whole company, on all the projects and all the things we are working on. The startup is really focusing on a very small part of the industry. They are focusing on renovations of kitchens in social housing. So it's a very small part of all our work, but that's the way we work with our startup. So they start very small, and they are going to scale up during the coming years. Startup is doing things like this. They are developing this platform or an app for this renovation of these kitchens. And a user or a person that lives in a social house that wants to renovate his or her kitchen gets this app and can configure that kitchen in the way she or he wants it to be. And I have a short video showing you what is going on there. So first, the scan is made of the existing kitchen, and a proposal is being put into this environment. And the user can select different materials, different kind of door handles. It can even move, for example, the stove, and automatically the hood is also moving. So automatically, a configurator here is being used to configure the new kitchen. And all the choices that are being made, of course, all the selections that are being made are stored in this platform. When the user is ready, finished, he hits the OK button. All the information is sent to the factory. The kitchen is being produced in exactly the correct format and is being sent to the home, and the kitchen is completely installed. So that's what the startup of BAM is working on, and they are going to scale up to a complete house, to a complete row of houses, adding infrastructure, going up to a complete city. And this is what I'm doing in the company, and it looks a little bit more dull, a little bit more standard. I'm working on this program with 15 work packages, trying to really raise the maturity of the use of digital construction in the company. Here, laying the foundation, things like governance and training and maturity assessment and IT infrastructure, all these kind of things. And on the top, we are really working on 3D design, 3D coordination, 4D, 5D, business controls, project controls, site controls, all these kind of things. And we are constantly measuring our progress in what we are doing. So we set up a number of KPIs for tenders, for projects, and some more general KPIs. We're really measuring every quarter where we are in the company and aiming towards a full digital company in 2020, and hope there to be faster than companies like Google and Katerra. Also doing these kind of measurements in the company, not only looking at digital construction, but also looking at people and culture, organization structures, IT, data, all these kind of things. And there we're working together with a PhD from the University of Twente. Last part of my presentation, I would like to really show you a number of examples, what we are really doing in all these steps of the company. So it's about the whole life cycle, doing these kind of things, the 3D, 4D, 5D, 6D. So 3D is really about building a three-dimensional geometry of our building. So that's including all the surfaces, that's including the steel structure, concrete structure, the facades, and the MEP. And we can combine all these disciplines in this 3D model, and we can do these clashes, as Norbert presented in his presentation. Then we add the dimension time. So we add a planning or a schedule to our 3D model, and we can do simulations of how a building is being erected. I will show you examples in a little bit. 5D is really about adding costs, the factor, money to the 3D model. So we can extract quantities and eventually costs out of this model. And 6D is really about quality control during the construction phase and hand over to the operation and maintenance phase. And if I go back to this circle, I will now run through these different steps and show you some examples of what we are actually doing in these steps. So we start with scanning the current environment. This is an example from our civil engineering company, our infrastructure company in the UK. You probably all recognize this building, the Tower Bridge in London. So a 3D scan has been done for that project before they really started the work. And you can see that they can even start measuring in these kind of 3D point cloud scans, because they're so precise, they're so actual. And it's even possible now with software to also automatically recognize objects out of these 3D point cloud scans. So software can recognize that this is a steel beam with a certain properties. So that's that's very spectacular what's happening in the technology at the moment. When this scan is ready, we start designing the new situation. Here again, an example from London City. This is the King's Cross area in London City, where BOM built most of these buildings and renovated most of these buildings. So we create this 3D model of this environment with all the information attached to it. And we are currently working in this area. It's the so-called coal drops area, where we are renovating some old coal terminals into a new shopping center. Designing is not only manually drawing all these objects, columns and beams and whatever, whatever you have, but we are using more and more of these kind of configurators, where we configure our model. So we just use some values here, for example, how many cubic meters of fresh air needs to be in this room, and automatically this software, this configurating, is getting placing the right diameters of these tubes in this example. So we're using more and more of these configurators to configure our projects, our models. And then we start simulating, and we are not only simulating the geometry, like you see here. So this lady is seeing the full 3D representation of the design of this new building. But we also do, for example, these kind of 4D simulation, really looking into logistics. And this is an example of the project I showed you earlier, the Museum of the Future in Dubai. And you see here in time how this building is being built. And we are now somewhere here, so you can see what the current status of the project is. Calligraphy you see here in the facade of this building is a famous poem by one of the sheikhs in Dubai, and this calligraphy is also the windows in this project. So it's the entrance of the daylight into the building. So you can imagine that especially the whole coordination of the facade and the steel structure and the concrete structure and all the installations in this project was very complex. To be sure that everything fits, there are no clashes, etc., etc. Yes. I showed you this one before, and we talked about this a little bit before. Here you see that we are starting to go into the physical phase. Once we completely created the digital twin of our project, we can start producing elements. And here you see the example of the 3D concrete bridge that we did. Where here you see at the bottom of this slide the actual printing of this bridge. Here you see that it's all the six elements are put together with reinforced concrete, reinforced steel cables, and finally placed on the construction site, as shown here. So this is the assembly phase of the project. But we also do that for building services. Here you see our factory, where we produce these kind of building services kits, standard elements of these building services, designed by the configurator I showed you earlier. And here you see that this has been brought to site for assembly of the process. I have one additional video I would like to show you. showing really our design to fabrication way of working for a project we are doing in the Netherlands.
The future of building will be defined by the capabilities of automation and by optimal use of digital construction technology. Although buildings consist of standard doors, floors and walls, custom parts also need to be made. BIM engineers at BAM have developed a method to produce these parts automatically. This is not only time-saving, but also reduces on-site waste. Let's take a look at one of BAM's projects, the Groninger Forum. The facade of this building is fitted with natural stone cladding and has a unique shape. Behind this natural stone cladding is a layer of 2,600 glass fiber reinforced boards, which make the building wind and waterproof. These panels are a fine example of an automated production process of unique building elements that were previously made by hand. An automated production process consists of a number of steps. We start by making a 3D model of the steel structure, which will support the glass fiber reinforced boards. We then generate a 3D model of the boards, including all openings and recesses for the steel construction. This model then directs the production machine, which produces the boards in numbered order of assembly. Finally, it is a simple job to mount these panels on site. Thanks to a model-driven production process, we save time and money in both engineering and execution. Always a perfect fit, there are no surprises and waste is limited. Above all, it inspires us to continue optimizing and automating the building process.
Attempts to really raise the productivity in the industry using these techniques to really, out of the 3D model, automatically produce these panels. And then finally we go into the use phase, where we are using our buildings, are maintaining our buildings. And this is an example from our school and hospital projects in the UK and Ireland, where all the technical rooms in these buildings are equipped with these RFID codes. And engineers or people that are servicing these buildings simply scan these codes, and I say RFID, but I mean it's different word, eh? Yes, QR codes, and the QR codes contain the information to link to the model, so the model is being displayed on the tablet with all the information that is needed to really maintain this equipment room. And we're using augmented reality techniques to really also assist in the operation and maintenance phase. And I have a short video here about using augmented reality in maintaining of sprinkler installations in hospital projects in the Netherlands.
Transform promising technology into new ways of working, which can be fully implemented in the organization. In this video, we zoom in on augmented reality. What is it? Why is it relevant for BAM, and what steps need to be taken to implement it on the work floor? Augmented reality is a technology which enhances the user's view of the real world by means of digital images, information, and holograms. At BAM, we believe this technology will have a huge positive impact on the execution of difficult and lengthy maintenance tasks by guiding service engineers through such tasks using digital instructions. But how can you implement such an idea? The key is to start small, with a single maintenance task. In this case, we take the maintenance of a sprinkler pump as an example. First, the sprinkler pump installation is laser scanned in such a way that its geometry is accessible for designing digital work instructions on a computer. Next, the entire workflow is carefully analyzed and each possible outcome of the task is considered. Then, instructions for each step are created and positioned at a convenient location for executing that specific step.
Creating this is like developing a car in the early 1900s. Everybody can see this will change the world, but no one can oversee where this is heading.
Finally, the instruction is tested extensively on-site by service engineers. As a result, BAM now has a fully operational augmented reality application which supports service engineers on sprinkler maintenance. The application offers a short instruction for each step, and the entire procedure is now automatically captured. The sprinkler maintenance pilot has proven that augmented reality drastically improves efficiency and minimizes risks in facility management.
So it really helps the service engineers to do all the tasks correctly, first time right. But it also stores all the information that's being done during this process. So all the things that are being done by these engineers is stored in a database. So I showed you some of the examples that we're acting on in our company, but of course there's a lot more. And we have information on our corporate website. There's a special digital section on our corporate website, and you can look into that for more information if you would like. There's a lot of videos there, information about our projects and how we apply digital technologies in our projects. To summarize, digital construction is really becoming the standard in our industry. And I think the mandates, like I talked about in the UK and other parts in Europe and in the world, are really accelerating the implementation of these digital technologies. So they're really mandating the use of this. We talked about digital twin, so doing things in a digital way first, preparing it fully digital, and then start going into the physical phase of a project. Norbert already talked about that also. Digital construction is not only for the design phase. BIM is not only for the design phase, but it's for the entire life cycle, very important, because there we can make most money. It's the information platform for the project, and we see more and more professional applications coming out. Things are in development, but it's going very fast, very, very fast, and it really contributes to the profit in projects. And it's about technique, it's about the technical side, it's about process, but also about people. And I think we are in the middle of an enormous transition. It only started 20, 30 years ago, what we're doing now. So in a way, it's still not very mature. So we are in a very big transition, and things are going very fast, are really going in a very fast pace. We need to manage this transition. It's very important. And a lot of the technical things and a lot of the processes are ready for applying these technologies. But the biggest problem is the human factor. We really need to do change and create change management in our people. Education is essential. So we're working a lot with universities and schools to really also educate about this topic. The architect has an important role, and the collaboration with the whole value chain is key, is very important. Last video showing you some sort of a summary of this presentation, and then I will finish this presentation.